and welcome to yet another episode of the Back to the TARDIS podcast, the podcast where we take a look at every single episode of the 2005 revival of BBC's Doctor Who. I'm Jeff.
I'm Skylar.
And I'm back. It's me, Celeste. I was Saturn last time, but I'm Celeste now. This is going to be a thing now. Cool. Okay. That's my introduction.
And today we are discussing Series 4, Episode 2, The Fires of Pompeii. This episode is Donna's first trip into the past, and they visit Pompeii right the day before Vesuvius blows up. This is also notable for early introductions of both Peter Capaldi and Karen Gillan. Very, very Scottish this week. I will say I think this one really stands out with, like, I think this. What puts this over the top is that this is a Donna episode. If this was a Martha episode, I'd be like, yeah, it's pretty good. It's better than Shakespeare Code, but it's Donna's sensibilities that I think really, really do this one for me. They land they say it's Rome, but of course this is a case of like, ha ha, he missed. There's a little gag about
it is technically what? The Roman Empire, but like, yeah, it's not Rome the city.
Yeah, there's also a joke that I really like where they decided to be like, they took the question of like, well, you speak in the language that the TARDIS is automatically translating to someone, what do you get? And everyone just thinks that they're like speaking in Welsh, which is really funny.
It's also especially funny because, like, you can, I was going to say this is the week of funny accents, because you have, you know, the very Scottish Doctor Who episode, and then you have just the like
Wales
Welsh accent argument in the Torchwood episode that just I could not
Wales.mp4.
and you have sort of the same thing in the Who episode with just these very thick Scottish accents like being loud back and forth. I'm not going to bother trying to do the accent, but it's very silly. As an American, it just sounds very silly.
Yeah. No, it's like I was playing, as I do every day, Final Fantasy 14. I'm a point where there's like the plot arc was set in like the kingdom of like the Fae folk, and they all speak in really thick Scottish accents.
nice.
And I'm like, oh, Scottish accents. Oh.
Yeah. I forget how, like, prevalent Donna's just immediately contrasting with Martha and Rose, of course. But,
yeah.
Like, it's all in the right ways. And I forgot how kind of, like Bill she would be, where she's just like, hey, how does this work? Hey, what about that? Like, every companion has that flavor to some extent, but that was a nice thing to bring out right away.
It's also interesting because it's a question that even the Doctor didn't know the answer to. He was like, well, shit, I never thought about that.
Yeah, no, there's definitely, a sense to this of, like, Donna is the most no-fuck-you companion. Where, like, if Ten's like, no, you can't do this, she'll be like, no, fuck you, I'm gonna do it anyway. Which I think is great. Um, So yeah, they then realize that they've landed in Pompeii, and immediately. Oh well, okay. Actually, no. First, there's the thing of like, someone sells the. I love how Peter Capaldi's character in this is introduced because they buy the TARDIS because they think it's modern art.
Insert commentary here.
Like that's wonderful. Absolutely fantastic.
How very meta.
Yeah.
I mean,
Indeed.
one of the thing, one of the perspectives I was bringing to this episode that I think made it, kind of interesting was just we're I mean, me in particular at this point are really into like anti-civ anarchist theory. And I feel like parts of this episode tie in really well to that, where it's just, you see the Romans doing all the exact same shit people do nowadays, and they're just like, they have like the loser teenage son who's just like,
Yeah, no,
ugh.
I was thinking like, man, it is really funny how these people are literally just like the same thing. Like they're
Yeah.
like it's played as like, haha, how modern.
Yeah, exactly. And like but the thing is, that's like fairly historically accurate to some extent. It's just like yeah, the Romans did all this shit. They had the like rich people who just like hoard art for no reason and then just like get all like excited about things they don't even art pieces they can't even understand or anything. It's just the same thing so said over
Yeah.
and over
Yeah.
again.
It had a very also like modern, not American, but like pull yourself up by your bootstraps type of thing where it's like,
Yeah.
the Roman dream. It's like, oh, I have this piece commissioned and we'll finally be richer. And then of course that's quite kind of like literally demonstrated when they go to Rome and like, yeah, they deserve it. They've lived through like a traumatic event, but still it's like very, I don't know, you could almost call it like sitcom-y and like very obvious commentary how the Roman family is. Of course, I like it because I always stand Capaldi. And they kind of like elevate
Yeah.
it. The actors are pretty good, actually, the side characters. But yeah,
Yeah, definitely.
that was really prevalent and fun.
Yeah. But yes, Peter Capaldi, as always, is great. He's great here, even though he doesn't have like anywhere near like he's at the stage where instead of being like a very like prominent lead force, he's just like a good side character actor, which is good because like him stealing the scenery completely would be kind of weird. Unlike the villain in this episode, who is fucking hilariously over the top.
It really feels like they were like, we need someone to be just a batshit crazy Roman soothsayer, and they
Yeah.
got that guy.
Yeah, definitely. It's really funny. Let me see here. But yeah, I like that they're throughout the entire episode, right? There's this push and pull between like Donna, who's like, well, why can't we save these people? And the doctor's like, well, cause reasons. And she's like, but why? And they like, I like that this is like a constant like conflict throughout the episode. And there's this very real, like, instead of like it just being like once where she's like, well, why can't we do this? And he's like, well, cause reasons. And then, like, it gets dropped. She continually calls him on it.
Yeah, it goes to the strength of the character that, like, this could easily come off as annoying because, like, we as the audience, we're already guessing, like, oh, yeah, of course you wouldn't be able to change that. But because it establishes her character and because it, frankly, also kind of establishes where Ten is at this point in time and, like, more about his whole deal, like, that's also pretty good stuff.
Yeah, which in turn I think in turn, I think it makes like the climax of the episode where they realize that not only can they not do anything to stop this, but that they also have to cause it is like that's really good.
Yeah, I have stuff to say when we get there. That's
Yeah.
all I'll say, but it's good.
So yeah, we're introduced to these soothsayers who just are kind of there throughout the episode up until like the reveal of the pyro vials. I love how they just immediately go with the I am Spartacus joke. Like just straight out. They just go for it.
The fact that that's the weakest joke, yet it still somehow works, is like
Because it's like,
pretty
haha,
good.
funny reference.
Also, apparently, the doctor also gets from Caecilius the inability to realize that people don't look how he thinks they do. He's just like, oh, yeah, brother and sister, that makes sense. And then later on, like, series eight, he's like, oh, yeah, how can you think that I'm Clara's dad when we look exactly the same age? It's like, no, buddy. No.
No, you don't.
So it's just like, yeah, deepening the lore. This is awesome. But no, seriously, yeah, that was a cute moment.
Yeah. Again, it's really funny, like the thing of like, well, he's like he's like, I only bought it today, and Ten's like, oh well, caveat emptor, and he's like, oh, you're Celtic, that's lovely. Just like the mic, like they keep going with the joke repeatedly, which is
Yeah,
great.
that's a joke it's a good because it starts as like a little thing and then it just keeps going. Yeah, it's definitely a good little movie. And that and the Spartacus joke continue through the entire episode, and it's a very good committal to the bit.
Yeah. Let's see here. Yes, we are then interest to introduce to Lucius, the chief augur of the city, who is the extremely hammy villain for this episode. The doctor.
That
Oh
character
yeah,
always
go
weirds
ahead.
me out. No, it's weird. That character always weirds me out because I had a drama teacher in high school who looked like exactly like him.
Wait, really?
Yeah, and like kind of, I know it's not the same person, but like acted like him too when we were doing like dramatic overacting, like pastiche isn't the right word, but like parody, like that type of stuff when we were going through
Yeah.
that. It's like the exact same type of energy. So that's just a very weird connection, but it's always just like, yeah, you go, Mr. I won't say his name, but yeah.
That's great. Let's see here. The doctor figures out that the vapors that the daughter who can see visions has been inhaling have dust in them, which, I mean, this is some fucking like, if you stare into the eyes of an angel, you become an angel bullshit, but whatever, it's entertaining.
I mean, basically, if you think about it, this entire episode is one large anti-vaping Remember, kids, don't vape. You never know what alien origin volcanic fumes you might be breathing in.
Don't give that lobby any nice. More ideas.
Donna tries. I like how Donna like tries and reveals like, "Hey, you're all gonna die. Please just get out." And everyone's like, "False prophecy," because like, especially because literally, like 10 like literally points out like, if you do that, that's what's gonna happen because this is how like the society works.
Yeah. The fucking, oh my god, the way she like starts saying that, and immediately the daughter like puts her hands up with the eye tattoos, and it's just like they fully embrace that. That was some classic era level,
yeah,
stuff. Yeah, so good stuff there.
Which, of course, yeah, immediately gets her. Oh, no, wait. First, there's, I like the thing of, like, I have, like, a weird, like, soft spot for shit that's, like, it's, like, old, ancient, low-tech versions of high-tech things. Like, I like the fact that they're making like circuit boards out of marble. Like, I think that's like really neat.
I definitely find that a lot of episodes set in the past often like tend to be pretty interesting, just because you know, it most episodes tend to be set either in like the future or in some sort of alien setting where there's access to technology.
Yeah,
and the doctor can just sort of, you know, they do the hand wavy, oh, he just like put some technology together.
Yeah, it's like how do you work around this?
Yeah, but then you instead of that, it's basically just, nope, what he has with him is all he's got to rough his way through it.
Yeah,
not gonna get any alien tech he can nick and then just, you know, reverse the polarity on to zap people with.
Yeah, definitely. It's revealed that Lucius's one of his arms is made out of stone, and is like his entire right side has like calcified, which is actually like, it could have looked a lot shittier than it did. Like, it's not the greatest, but it doesn't look bad.
Yeah. If anything, the skin makeup for, like, the High Priestess and, like, how it looks on, I forget the daughter's name, but, like, that looks a bit better, but it's still, it's not bad.
Yeah, definitely. So it's revealed that the monsters for this episode are a race called the Pyroviles. Kind of an interesting design. Obviously they're going to be like volcano fire people because, like, duh, it's a Pompeii episode. What the fuck did you expect? Donna gets captured. And then yeah, we move into like the big climax of the episode where they realize that to stop the Pyroviles, they have to cause Pompeii.
This is my favorite moment.
I think that works a lot better than like the whole like, oh, this is a fixed point in time shit. Like, I think, like, yeah, there's the fixed point in time stuff and that's understandable, but if you have the stake of like, this hurts not just because it's a fixed point in time but because it was actually like the lesser evil of the situation, I think is like a really good, well-written gut punch.
Yeah, this the whole sequence of them like escaping the place and then all the way up to figuring out they have to do this if they want to like save the future is like it has so many great stuff. First, it has Ten's like real explanation of why, if this is a fixed point in time, how he knows that. That's some good like angst curse of the Time Lords, like memes, but it's pretty good there. And just kind of, I don't know, I found a weird parallel with Day of the Doctor and how he has to do this horrible thing, but Donna's not gonna let him do it alone. And the fact that she's been campaigning like all this time, like screw you, I'm warning people, for her to accept that just quietly and like put her hand on the lever too, and look at him, it's just like that was really powerful stuff. Like, damn, Donna, getting put through the emotional ringer, like in your first episode in the Christmas special, and this one is like, wow.
Donna definitely, like, just within this episode, like, even just within this episode, Donna matures a lot as a companion. And I you know, sort of what you said, her perspective shifts over the course of it as she sort of comes to understand just the sort of powerlessness they have in some situations.
Oh yeah, there's also I completely forgot to mention the running thing throughout the episode of the Doctor fending off the pyroviles with a tiny little squirt pistol that he has throughout the entire episodes.
Yeah, that was perfect.
And like it's funny because it's like A, like that's a tiny water pistol, how the hell would that work? And B, just the fact that you see the Doctor with a gun and it's a water pistol.
Yeah, the whole like, oh, that's fine. It's just us girls. Like, again, kind of meta now, 'cause you're like, oh yeah, that's gonna happen. But yeah, just
So I like that for a couple reasons. One, it's a very silly moment. Just in general, this is like this is an episode that's like sort of right like I said before, it's a very middle of the road episode in a lot of the ways, and I think that comes through in tone as well, because in a lot of ways, there's a sort of somber attitude to it all because it's fucking Pompeii and everyone's gonna fucking die. But at the same time, they do like slip a lot of they're jokes, but they don't really take away from the gravity of the situation.
Yeah,
And it's things like
definitely.
the Celtic joke and the Spartacus joke and then the like water pistol, which is just and I think what makes the water pistol work well is that it genuinely makes sense in the situation. Like, yeah, of course they're lava people. Of course the silly water pistol does something to them.
And
So
as I mentioned, the humor in the fact that like you see the doctor with a gun and it's a water pistol.
yeah, what was the the like absolute no guns thing, has that been established yet? I can't remember.
The no gun thing really comes in later in the season with Doctor's daughter. All in general, like it like in general, like the Doctor expresses a distaste for guns. Like Ten's like very much no violence in general, but like even the ones who are willing to fucking like crack skulls when they get to it. Like for example, like Seven
Seven,
still don't like guns
yeah,
specifically.
the like
Though
scene where Seven,
in that case, you almost get the sense that like Seven doesn't like guns because he think they make things too easy.
which is ironic
Mad
because
lad.
then that's how he gets fucking murked.
Yeah, exactly.
It was a premonition. That's why he didn't like guns all along. Because I mean, yeah, Seven is like perfectly willing to literally C4 a motherfucker, but then he's like really finicky about guns, and then that's what gets him. So, anyways, just the thing with Ten and the water pistol is, in my mind, I was just, when you mentioned the like gun thing, I was just imagining 13 seeing someone with a water pistol and being like, "Hey, no, put that
No.
down." We don't need that violence here.
Sorting out fair play throughout the universe.
Go
Kill
on.
me.
Yeah, no, I wanna like, yeah, we all have we the, like there's obviously there's thin ice where like 12 just like decks a racist. I want like want them to go like next step further where like the like there's literally even a monologue of like no you can't like beat me up because then you'll be no better than me and then like he literally gets clocked over the head by the doctor. I don't care if it's 13 or just whoever's incumbent, just the doctor clonks him over the head with a baseball bat. Hard.
That would be amazing. I hope someday in the future there can be a base doctor who joins some militant organ anti-racist organization.
The,
The doctor works.
no, because okay, not militant. Militant is the wrong word
Okay,
because
not
the
militant, but
doctor
like
does not like military.
any group willing to use violence, I'd say, in
Yeah.
self-defense. So like the Black Panthers or something.
Yeah. Comrade 12.
I'm just picturing Five just like beating the shit out of someone with his cricket bat.
No, that's six. Six would absolutely like just murk someone. I'm pretty sure six actually does murk like a bunch of people in his episodes, usually followed by one-liners.
Based. Yeah, I mean, it's a good comedic bit. It's good character. It's, again, it leads up to my favorite thing of the episode, which is underneath the mountain slash volcano.
Yeah.
Just all around good jokes. I think my personal favorite is the son saying like, "Don't tell my dad," and then the doctor's like, "Well, don't tell mine," which like makes no sense, but I'm just like, "Aw, he quips."
No, that I think that's definitely like a line that is like that's supposed to be like just him like being cool with the kids.
Yeah. But yeah,
Which, yeah.
there's a lot of that. So it's a good culmination of all the quips and all the drama and like entertaining exposition. So I'm a fan.
Yeah. I like how you get the feeling that oh God, he's like he does it, but he's really not happy about doing it, and like you can tell because he literally just like gets in the TARDIS and like starts up the engines before Donna is on board. He wants to be out of there. And then, like, of course, Donna pleads him to save Caecilius and his family, which is one of the best moments of the episode. Yeah, and of course, it's also
Quips.
lore important for later
Yeah.
because it's why 12 looks like that. Which totally was an ass pull, but I appreciate it.
I appreciate the effort of the ass pull. Yeah. Yeah, that the whole like sequence from like the moment they land and it's an escape pod to like 10 taking off and even to like the family watching what's happening to their like city is just great stuff. It's like it's rare you get that type of like just realistic dread and horror, and it's just like, oh my God, like ash is literally coming down and you're seeing it bury people alive, and like
Yeah.
nobody, there's like no way to
And
help
nobody, yeah.
99% of these people.
And nobody's like nobody is like nobody's like everyone like even Donna is like no don't go to the beach. And like literally like they literally don't even know like how to not die
Yeah.
horribly.
Yeah, so that's good. And the whole like it's kind of cliche maybe, but the fact that he's literally like the TARDIS comes back and it's just like blinding light
Yeah.
and you know, maybe it's the fact that like we're, you know, we've lived through the 12 era. We've seen Peter Capaldi be the doctor, but it feels when Ten and Caecilius like grab hands and he pulls that family into the TARDIS, that feels like an establishing moment. Like this is important.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, so I think the only thing I'd say to slightly critique it is that moment where he's like, the god Vulcan must be enraged. It's so volcanic. It
Volcanic. Yeah, no,
fucking felt
that's
what I
absolutely that's an ass pull because they already made the comment that like the word volcano physically didn't exist before this.
Yeah,
Yeah, that's like
I thought to the movie Star Trek First Contact, where that one character is like, so you're all on some sort of Star Trek. It was just like, okay, roll credits, fuck you.
Roll credits.
No, do not reference the Forbidden Channel.
Fair enough.
But everything else is good, fuck you.
And then the ending where like they are worshipped as the new household gods for that family, which is great because like of course that's what they're going to take away from this. Of course that's what it is.
Yeah. I appreciate the integrity of having the kid be studying to be a doctor, yet
Yeah, that's great.
they never know that's his name. They just still think it's Spartacus.
A title.
Oh, that's
Yeah.
true. You never
So it's
actually talked
like
about it.
they did the thing, but they didn't do the thing, and I was just like, you know what? You've earned it. You've earned it, episode.
Yeah, definitely.
What I like about the being a doctor thing is just in my head while we were watching that scene, I was just sort of like, okay, but he's like a Roman doctor, so his whole thing is gonna be talking to people about their humors and shit, like.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He has a nice robe, don't think about it.
Yeah.
Fuck.
So yeah, I guess moving on to ratings, as I said, I think what sets this episode apart is how it does, how it blah, 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 blah. Yeah, that core, I guess, like quandary at the center of the episode, or that relationship between Ten and Donna, where there's like the sense of like, well, why don't you say anything? Why don't you save someone? And while like obviously like the episode has to have another plot besides that, and it definitely feels like, okay, we're doing the plot stuff now so we can get to the cool shit. Like, it's still really, really solid. And I think like when it really gets like fires on all fours, it is like you really see like how well Tennant and Tate like bounce off each other and are foils and all that great stuff. So yeah, I definitely give this an A.
Yeah, this episode is not like perfect, but there's a lot of stuff to elevate it from what could be like on paper a very average script. You have Donna and the Doctor, and their chemistry is just great, and Donna is established very clearly as being different, but also like a good companion for Ten, someone who needs to like challenge him a bit at this point in time. This is kind of like retroactive, but there's also like a there's an importance to the history of the show in this episode of where the Doctor will kind of be. It doesn't make that much sense because we have 11 before we get 12, which is, you know, I'm not touching that, but whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah, Karen Gillan, you know, cool. Like, there's all that stuff.
She's there.
yeah, doing a somewhat questionable, like highly aristocratic British accent, but you know, she gets better. She's in Marvel movies. We know she gets
Yeah.
better at faking her
Well,
accent.
doesn't she just do the Scottish accent in Marvel movies?
No, she does American.
Does
Like,
she?
yeah, like flat, like, yeah.
Oh.
So yeah, that's a whole thing. And I'd say probably the biggest thing in favor of this episode is that Doctor Who is like a lot of TV shows, and that they can either live or die on the quality of their side characters and the actors that portray them. And while this is no like Human Nature, Family of Blood, like the side characters and acting isn't that like perfect, you still have Peter fucking Capaldi there, so it's like
Yeah.
it's still pretty good.
The God, yeah.
Exactly, the based 12 king. So yeah, just all that adds together to make something really enjoyable and something kind of meaningful, even though, again, you look at it and you look at the plot and you're just like, well, that's kind of average, but it's not. It's like pretty good. So I'd give this episode an A minus.
So sort of what I said before is that this is just it's a very middle of the road Doctor Who episode, which means it's a good episode because Doctor Who
Yeah.
is a good show.
Yeah,
So,
like, yeah,
which is why
that
I ended
is
up at
true.
like
Like, a mid-tier Doctor Who
Doctor
episode
Who
would
episode
possibly be,
possibly
like,
be
one
one
of
of the
the
best
best episodes
episodes
of
of
a
a
lesser
lesser
show.
show. And so that's why I ended up at a sort of like 7.5 range, 7.5 to maybe like 7.75 if I'm really splitting hairs here, you know? That's sort of the range I was thinking for this episode because it is like genuinely it's a well put together episode. As you said, the side characters are good. You obviously have the based King Capaldi doing his thing, being a based king. You have Donna just absolutely smashing it. You have what is altogether a pretty good plot. It's engaging. It keeps things going. You know, there's nothing special to write home about the pyro, whatever the fucks, but like they're there. They do what they need to. They're good. They're
Yeah.
entertaining to watch. They do their
They
thing and they
work
get
in the
out.
context of the episode.
Yeah. And besides that, you know, there's nothing like to stand out, but there's nothing that really stands out badly either. It's just a very functional, good Doctor Who episode. Like, you know,
Yeah.
as I said, if I were thinking about Doctor Who episodes that feel like Doctor Who episodes, this is probably one of the ones I might go to. You know, this and something like 42, or like maybe something, I'd say maybe like the heist episode later on. You know, ones like that are just sort of like
Yeah.
they're not brilliant, but they're very fun, and you can sit down and watch them and enjoy them. And yeah, 7.5 to 7.75 out of 10. Good average Doctor Who episode.
Good shit. Yeah. All right. Well, next week, we will be talking about series 4, episode 3, Planet of the Ood. But until then, we're going to move on to our next segment. So this week, we are talking about Torchwood Series 2, Episode 4, Meet, which means we finally, after, so I guess our Discord server, which you can find a link to on our Twitter account if you aren't already a part of it, has a channel in it called Reese Posting that is entirely for all your Reese meme needs. Which was exacerbated by the fact that this week we finally got to talk about the episode with the Harwoods Lorry jingle. Like, that's not even like the best part of the episode. It's just there and it's good. But yeah, this is the episode where after Reese spending a series and almost a series and a half being completely oblivious to the fucking bullshit Gwen's been up to, finally, getting like figuring out about Torchwood, And there's also this plot about this huge, like, space whale that falls through the rift and is literally getting, like, cut into and having its flesh sold while it still lives. Which is metal as fuck when you think about it, but not great. This is a really good episode. And, like, I feel like, I guess in some sense, to go with the Pompeii thing, I think part of the reason why I reacted as strongly as I did to Fires of Pompeii is that I only think I've watched that episode, like, once or twice. Like, I had, like, I expected it to be, like, a lot less interesting than it turned out to be. So the fact that it turned out really good was pretty cool to me. Whereas this, like, I'd seen this more recently and I'd rewatched it more. So, like, I knew that this episode slapped hard because obviously it did, because Rhys is consistently one of the best characters on the show, and it has the Harwood's Lorry jingle and it has the space whale.
I think it's pretty... There.
Go ahead.
I think it's pretty interesting that they have a space whale in this one, and then, you know, Beast Below is in season 5, and it's like,
yeah, I know Petra noted that, like, a couple weeks ago about how, like, they're both space whale episodes, but they go vastly different ways.
Yeah,
I would say it's not just the space whale thing, it's space whale being exploited by humans to sustain something.
And yeah, true. It's
honestly very... Okay, wait, can do you know what year season 2 of Torchwood came out?
It came out along the same year as series 4, so like 2008.
Mm-hmm. Okay. See, so that would be way after the 2005 album by... Well, then death metal, now prog metal band Gojira, with their most famous, or not most famous, but best album, From Mars to Sirius, which is about humans destroying the Earth and then going to space to find space whales to help save the planet. And it's just very interesting to me that this, you know, sort of middlingly famous, very well-regarded death metal album, it holds basically the same formulas as these two episodes from Doctor Who, you know, the Hooniverse. And I'm genuinely, like, were there people writing these episodes that had listened to that album?
I don't necessarily think so. Yeah, I don't think so. At
it's
least
such
not
like a
this
specific
case. Yeah, because there's this one, and then Beast Below is written by Moffat. And I don't think Moffat listens to Gojira.
That's got to be on the interview questions when we finally get big enough in 75 years to interview him.
Hey, what the hell were you thinking with this one?
I mean, it's just, you know, this is something that we've actually been wondering for a long time, because, you know, this, you know, that's one of our favorite albums, and it's just such a weirdly specific motif for it to crop up, like, again and again like this. Like, humans working with / using space whales to do something,
I mean,
related to
okay, here's my thought. When you think about it, right, the thing, like, we already as humans have misused and mistreated earth whales for their resources, so then what would make sense as the next logical step but space whales?
That's literally the second... That's literally the second Trek connection. A Voyage Home, Star Trek 4. It's like, yeah.
Space whales?
We gotta go back in time. But no, yeah. It's something I've... I mean, obviously we haven't gotten there yet. I'll be curious to see how my opinions of Beast Below have changed or haven't changed, because I generally regard Series 5 as in my top 3 series of all time, but that's probably top 5 now. Anyways, yeah, it's an interesting through line, and the episode does smart stuff with it, and the implications, and I really want to listen to that album now, Celeste, so thank you.
Do it. It's really good. Anyways, yeah. Just back to the episode.
Yeah.
God, what was I going to say? Oh, I guess my sort of main comment for the episode was just about Jack. I mean, I guess I have a couple comments about Jack. One, Jack is very good in this episode. He's turning up the Horby in this one.
Yeah. I like the thing where like he gets into a shouting match with Reese and then just pauses and like almost looks at the camera and goes, "This is very homoerotic."
And my favorite thing about that is that like in the shot he's looking at Gwen, and so he's literally like telling Gwen, like he's basically asking Gwen, like, "Hey, can I like make out with your boyfriend?"
Like, this one funny? Yeah, can I fuck your fiance?
Our based consenting queen.
And then there's the
I just okay, I just can I just take a moment to get on a soapbox and say that the best ending to Torchwood would not have been Children of Earth. It would have been the ending where Jack, Gwen, and Reese get polyamorously married.
You're not wrong.
I know damn well I'm not wrong.
Yeah, no, I agree. All right, what was I gonna say? Right. Then there's the one earlier. What was it? So have you ever had alien meat? Yeah. Was it any good? And it was like, well, he seemed to enjoy it, and I'm like, hey.
Yeah.
Joke you can't say on Doctor Who number 4069.
Yeah. Oh yeah, man. The goofs are great.
Oh, and then the like more serious comment about Jack was that he seems to have been genuinely affected by Sleeper. Like he seems to be holding a lot of guilt over that, because as like the characters note in this episode, he's the one really trying to save the space whale, and then he's like actually very sad when he fails at it.
Yeah, no, like that is genuinely like the super touching moment where he's just like I'm sorry I couldn't save you. That was like, yeah, that was fantastic.
Yeah, I have nothing to add. Really, really good stuff. Series 2 of Torchwood is popping off, and series 4 of Doctor Who, to be honest. It's kind of it's kind of great and refreshing sustainable the quality has been recently.
Yeah, no, definitely. Like series 2, like I definitely get the feeling that like series 2 like really feels like they got their shit figured out. Like they go like, oh yeah, right, that's how we do this. I guess the other thing that like I would talk about is how like I like how, like, in general, I think one of the things that has helped has been, like, how, like, relatively, like, lower scale everything has felt. Like, admittedly, like, stuff last season was pretty low scale, but, like, the fact that, like, yes, there's an alien here, but the alien isn't the villain, and the only reason the alien is in the plot is because you have, like, two shitty people. You have, like, this, like, shitty, like, person who's just doing it to get money, because hey, it's a meat source. People need to eat, don't they? And like the thing that he says where like he says that like there's also like the I don't know, it feels like there's like a hint of commentary too, where he says that like the only reason he's doing this is because he's never really had anything else in his life that he could be like proud of or got him anywhere. Although I do feel like there's kind of like for example, like the brother who's like been the one like consistently getting like disturbing amounts of ketamine to like try and make sure that this creature suffers as little as possible is kind of shunted to the side. But like that being said, like I kind of understand why, because there isn't really like any space in the episode for him.
Yeah, just
yeah, I mean, yeah, I guess it's just a damn good episode of Torchwood in a way that like not too many episodes had been in series one. And I also think, oh, one more thing. I also like how I feel like if this was series one, they would have retconned Reese. And I like that here Gwen just puts her foot down and goes like, no, I'm not going to do that. That's really shitty.
Yeah. I think it's a thing that's like not so overt, but I kind of wish was more that the character of Gwen kind of changes Torchwood for the better. I mean, that it's debatable how text and how like subtext that is.
I mean, it's already mentioned, like, in the canon of, like, he says, like, I hired her because she pointed out our bullshit.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. So, yeah, I mean, that's good stuff right there. And also, like, just from a narrative point of view, if you're just, like, fucking every time someone accidentally, like... Not that there's a lot of people to do this with, because the side characters, like, there aren't many. But if that happened every time, where it was, like, a very comic book, like, oh, let's erase their memory, like, fuck that. So, I'm glad that there's a change here, basically.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, like, it's just a damn solid episode, and, like, really, I have nothing else to say other than, like, it's definitely, like... an A-plus tier episode of Torchwood.
Yeah, I didn't feel as strongly. I mean, like, critically, I agree. Obviously, I have more prior investment with Doctor Who. But I still think, you know, we're just giving away A's this series of Torchwood and Doctor Who, but they're earning it, 'cause...
Yeah.
Damn, like
consistent quality.
Yeah, I'm definitely interested going forward in seeing how the series maintain or drop or excel in quality. So yeah, A.
I would say it's a pretty solid episode. I wouldn't say it's quite as good as some of the like season one episodes yet. The overall quality of the season has definitely been better. I don't think it's quite reached the peaks of the first season yet, though.
Yeah.
So I'd say this is about a 9.
All right. Yeah, that's fair. Next week, we will be discussing series 2, episode 5, Adam. Until then, you can follow the podcast on Twitter at B2TardisPod. You can support us on Patreon for a lot of perks like listening into the show live and possibly guest starring on an episode and getting early access to episodes. I'm Jeff. You can find me on Twitter at WheelieDL.
I'm Karen Gillan's aristocratic accent. You can find me on Twitter at skyhigh9_5.
I'm a hot bitch dyke, and you can find me at are we still Big Fat Penis 69? Yes, we are. I'm going to have to change that soon.
Really? Pog. All right, and we'll see y'all next week.